Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal, Professor Department Chair. So this is going to be a demonstration of the strap muscles of the neck, that is the infrahyoid and the suprahyoid muscles, and the branches of the ANSA cervicalis which supply them, and a few of the triangles formed by these strap muscles. This is a supine cadaver, this is the right side of the neck, I'm standing on the right side, the camera person is also on the right side. So first let's take a look at this muscle here, this is the sternocleidomastoid. We have cut it here, the distal portion is here, the proximal portion is here. Let's take a look at this triangle. This is carotid triangle. What are the boundaries of the carotid triangle? The posterior boundary is formed by the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid. The inferior boundary is formed by the superior belly of the omohyoid. And the superior boundary is formed by this muscle here. This is the posterior belly of digastric. And under that, this muscle here, this is the stylohyoid muscle. So therefore, this triangle that we see here is the carotid triangle. And as you would have already guessed, it contains the common carotid artery and its bifurcation into the internal and the external carotid artery. It contains the internal jugular vein and the vagus nerve. It also contains the carotid sinus and the carotid body, which is located in the bifurcation. Roof of this triangle is the platysma, and the floor of the triangle is the muscular part of the tracheal fascia. The next triangle that we're going to see is this triangle. So let's take a look at the boundaries. In the midline, we have an imaginary line in the middle of the neck. Posterior superiorly, we have this line. This is, again, the superior belly of the omohyoid on the right side. And posterior inferiorly, we have the continuation of the sternocleidomastoid, which had been present here, it would have been like this. So therefore, we can see another triangle here. This is the omotracheal or the muscular triangle. Again, the roof of this triangle is formed by the platysma, and the floor of the triangle is formed by the visceral part of the pretracheal fascia. The contents of this triangle are, number one, this structure here. The anterior jugular vein and the jugular venous arch, and we can see that here. So I'm going to reflect this up. Next content is infrahyoid strap muscles, which are incidentally covered by the muscular part of pretracheal fascia. And the next content is thyroid gland, which is located here. Having mentioned that, now let's take a look at this strap muscles here. Neck muscles are divided into two groups. This is the hyoid bone. Muscles below the hyoid are called infrahyoid muscles, and the muscles above the hyoid are called the suprahyoid muscles. So let's take a look at this infrahyoid muscles first. This is inferior belly of the omohyoid. It was cut here because during the process of embalming, they cut this. This inferior belly of the omohyoid takes origin from the scapula, and it goes up like this. Under the sternocleidomastoid, it becomes tendinous, and we can see the intermediate tendon here. And the intermediate tendon is attached by means of a facial sling, which also goes under the sternocleidomastoid and gets attached to the clavicle. Therefore, at the intermediate tendon, the muscle changes direction. And thereafter, we have the superior belly of the omohyoid, which gets attached to the hyoid bone. So this is one infrahyoid strap muscle. Then we have the next strap muscle that we can see here. That is this one here. This is the sternohyoid muscle. It extends from the posterior surface of the mandibulum sterni, and it goes up and gets attached to the hyoid bone. Once we reflect this, then we see the next muscle under that. This is the sternothyroid. This also takes attachment from the inner surface of the manubrium sterni, and it goes up and it gets attached to the oblique line of the thyroid cartilage. And we can see that line here. So this is the sternothyroid. And exactly from the place where this muscle gets inserted, we have the next muscle starting up. And we can see that muscle here. I'm going to lift it up here. This is the thyrohyoid muscle, which extends from the oblique line of the thyroid cartilage and gets attached to the hyoid bone. So therefore, the infrahyoid strap muscles are omohyoid, sternohyoid, sternothyroid, and the thyrohyoid. What is the function of these infrahyoid strap muscles? They pull down the hyoid bone, or to stabilize it, to enable the suprahyoid muscles to work. Now let's come to the suprahyoid. We can see only a few of them. We can see this muscle here. This is the posterior belly of digastric. Digastric means it has got two bellies. The posterior belly takes origin from the mastoid process. Again, it becomes an intermediate tendon here in the region of the hyoid bone. And it is attached to the hyoid bone by means of a facial sling. And after that, we have the anterior belly of digastric, which is this one here, which gets attached to the inner surface of the mandible. And this forms the boundaries of the digastric or the mandibular triangle. Just under the posterior belly of digastric, we have this muscle. This is the stylohyoid muscle, which also forms the posterior boundary of the digastric triangle. This extends from the stylohyoid process to the hyoid bone, and at the place where it is getting inserted on the hyoid bone, the tendon splits to allow the tendon, intermediate tendon of the digastric to pass through. What is not visible here in this dissection? Under the anterior belly of digastric, we have the mylohyoid, and under that will be the geniohyoid. So these are the suprahyoid muscles. What are the functions of the suprahyoid strap muscles? Number one, they pull up the hyoid bone, and that is necessary during swallowing or deglutition, more specifically during the second phase of swallowing, pharyngeal phase of swallowing. And the other function of the suprahyoid strap muscles is to depress the mandible when it has been fixed by the infrahyoid strap muscles. So therefore, they also act as accessory muscles of mastication. That brings me to the nerve supply of these neck muscles. We can see this nerve here. This is the hypoglossal nerve. It comes from the hypoglossal canal and it crosses in front of the internal and external carotid, and it enters the tongue by going deep to the mylohyoid muscles, superficial to the hyoglossus. And here it gives a branch. We can see that branch here. This is the branch to the thyrohyoid. And deeper inside, it gives a branch to the geniohyoid. These two branches, to the geniohyoid and the thyrohyoid, strictly speaking, are not from the hypoglossal nerve. They are coming from the C1-C2 loop, that is the superior limb of ANSA cervicalis. And we can see clearly the branch going to the thyrohyoid. So this is the supply to the geniohyoid and the thyrohyoid. Accompanying this again, the hypoglossal nerve, we have the rest of the superior limb of ANSA cervicalis, which comes from the C1-C2 loop. And we can see it is supplying the omohyoid. So this is the superior limb of ANSA cervicalis. What is not visible is we'll have another loop which comes from the C2 and C3 and which forms the descending limb of ANSA cervicalis or the descending cervicalis. And that forms the loop of ANSA cervicalis, and that supplies the rest of the strap muscles, namely the sternohyoid, the sternothyroid, and the omohyoid. And we can see the nerve supply to the omohyoid also here. The posterior belly of digastric and the stylohyoid, they are supplied by branches of the facial nerve. So therefore, these are derived from the second pharyngeal arch. The anterior belly of digastric and the mylohyoid is supplied by CN5V3, mandibular nerve. So therefore, they are derived from first pharyngeal arch. So these are the nerve supply of the infrahyoid and the suprahyoid muscles. And we have already seen how these muscles form the triangles of the neck. Before I conclude, just to complete the picture, I will draw your attention again to the omohyoid muscle here. The inferior belly of the omohyoid divides the lateral cervical region into a lower portion, which is referred to as the subclavian triangle, and an upper portion, which is referred to as the occipital triangle. The subclavian triangle contains the subclavian artery, and we can see the subclavian artery here. That's why it is called the subclavian triangle. It is also referred to as omoclavicular triangle. And the superior portion of the triangle is referred to as the occipital triangle because it contains the occipital artery, which we can see here. So therefore, this inferior belly of omohyoid also helps to divide the lateral cervical region into two triangles. So these are the triangles and the infrahyoid and the suprahyoid muscles that I wanted to show you. Thank you very much for watching. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. Mr. Kendall Cumberbatch is the camera person. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Have a nice day.